All right, we are live on Tuesday night. Welcome to the Dr. Boz Show. I am so excited to tell you what just happened in my clinic just a few minutes ago, and almost a little sad because it was a huge undertaking for me, but I wish I could capture you and bring you into the clinic and show you exactly what happened. This week has been the fifth of the support groups that I have been running as a bonus for the online course. And dang, the winner of this bonus was totally me. As I led a support group for the first time, exampling how this looks, I couldn't be more delighted to have made the friendships and just to tell you a little bit about what it did for me as a leader and what happened with several of the folks that joined us. So welcome to the Dr. Boz Show. We are going to start with some of the traditions we have, which is checking my ketone numbers and sharing them, as well as looking at a few of, I have a couple of technical things that I am totally praying to God that all works out like it's supposed to. So stick around. And then at the end of the show, I will be offering offering several of the question and answers that we've been really looking for. People who've said, Dr. Boz, I've written into your show and ask you to answer these questions. And we've just said, you know what, the best way to get those answered is type them in during the show. And I have a team out there really helping me get ready for those questions at the end. And the workflow has worked really nice. I'm excited about that. So yeah, my fast is now at about 48 hours and I've got an 85 glucose and a 1.9 ketone. If somebody can run the numbers for me, I really am, I can't do that kind of math in front of people. So I am drinking some ketones tonight because I am definitely parched, but I also want to just make sure that you guys can hear me. Oh, yes, I hear Boz. Okay, yeah, I hear Boz. That's a good. I just needed one person to say that you can hear me. And then I'm just drinking some raspberry ketones, mainly because it's open and I could get it done right before that's what took me just a little bit longer than I wanted, was that the ketones are, they were not within reach, so I had to unplug, walk over and grab them. So tonight, before we get to, I'm just gonna give you a quick little sneak peek of the folks that I'm talking about tonight. I'll see if I can see it over there. There you go. These are the folks that were chosen as my support group. And I look across this photo and I'm so just thankful for these folks saying yes to being in a support group and letting me film their first 5 weeks, and have the coolest recap for you. So stick around. Before we do that, though, I'm going to make some announcements, some of which I didn't do such a great job of last week, but I am going to share, because I had several people scold me saying, why didn't you tell me? All right, so if you go to bozmd.com, there are a couple things that I put on super sale. And one of them is like, this is about 10 cents on the dollar for what it costs me to make these. So it is a 10 pack for $22.77. I think there's like 30 of them left. I know it said only 40 packs available, but there were actually 80 available when I got down to the count. And so we have about, I think before the show it was like 30 left. So if you don't know what these are, I put these as a 10 of them cost you $22, and they've got one little strip on the back that hangs onto the refrigerator. And this is if you are running a support group, this is the best way to have folks that say, hey, I haven't been part of a support group, or what's that keto thing, or how do you eat keto? And if you're looking for the quickest answer, hang that up in your workspace or in your community kitchen at work, that gets you a little bit of information on what does it really look like to eat keto. I love it. Actually, when I have a patient that's struggling, I still give this out to them saying, show me where you're at. Circle the foods that you eat. And that process has been just the greatest teaching tool that, much like everything that I approach in my clinic, I don't ask patients to start out perfect. I just say, follow the stuff in the good column. And when you master that, move to the the better column. And when you finally get to the best part of keto, you'll be living in that best column. But don't start there. Anyway, so the reason they're on super sale is because I have a product that has been, I needed to get that one off the shelf and put this one, which I have been totally dying to show off. Let's see if I can go back to the front end and then I'll come back to this scene here. Okay, so this I'll take that picture away. This is the keto guide, the one I just told you about, but it is a 100% magnet, and on the back side is the keto continuum. So I actually gave these away to the folks that were here at the support group. At least I think everybody got one. The magnet is double-sided because about the time patients figure out what is on the diet is when they're getting keto adapted. They've kind of got that idea down. And I tell them that's the time you flip the magnet over, and that tells you the keto continuum, which are the steps that are outlined in the book that I wrote and the online course. And it's at this point that they should start caring, because the first few weeks of keto, they shouldn't start caring. So this double-sided magnet, it's kind of like a menu is what it feels like. The man who helps me make these was really creative in saying, I think this is what you should use. So it's really heavy, it's really durable. You can write on it and wipe it off. And I just love it. I've been afraid to share it because I only had a few prototypes, and everywhere I went, people would just take them and say, no, 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 can I have that? Can I have that? I'm like, I only have three of them. But they are finally for sale on the website. And I'm very thankful for the package there, which still has the little booklet, still has the fridge guide that's the one-sided, the one that comes in the 10-pack, but the opposite side of it is now the keto continuum. And I will tell you, this is really the roadmap that you need for beginning to end. And I thought I would put this out at the same time that I got the workbook done, but I just couldn't do one more thing. So it goes through there, it talks through how I think you should use it. I'm really excited about just showing that product off, because I think many people who are struggling saying, what do I do next? And it really is in that keto continuum. If you've listened to the book, if you've read the book, that it will make it much easier to remember where you're at in that keto continuum. You know, the final thing that I want to share with you is about 3 weeks ago, I'm going to show you the dates here. It was in October, it was after October, and I was thankful for the review written on October 21st, but then went a couple of weeks without a single review. And I think I begged. I think I begged somebody to say, please write a review. The reviews are super important. And this is on the keto continuum. But I want to say that you guys totally stepped up, and there's three more reviews for the book. You have no idea how important this is for the journey that an independent author is on. And I love these. I read all of them. So I'm going to share the one by James, because I think there's just a lot of hope in his message. I read Any Way You Can first, which is fantastic. I had been doing low carb and keto for 3 years, and then Keto Continuum was published, and I read it. Very informative, easy to read, and followed the program outlined in the book. I lost the last 15 pounds to meet my goal weight, and now my BMI is at the healthy level. Most importantly, I feel better than ever. I haven't been sick since I started following the keto lifestyle. No more colds or flus or pneumonia. Less inflammation overall. Thank you, Dr. Boz, for all you do. I wish more doctors knew about the ketogenic lifestyle. And that's why I get on this silly show on Tuesdays and I make all of the technical errors that I still do, is that I do think that my colleagues are looking for the help in medicine that a genuine anti-inflammatory diet could offer. As an internist who's written lots of prescriptions, I have this goal of stopping as many prescriptions as I've started. And I've been in this 20 years, so I have a lot of prescriptions to stop. There were two more reviews on the 12th, one by Rickster. And having done Atkins and generally low-carb diets, but hit the wall so many times, each time I gained it all back, yo-yo and extreme. If you want to know how to succeed, this book is for you. That is perfect, Rickster. And finally, Eric writes in and says, my wife and I have been doing keto for 2.5 years. I'm 64 years old and type 2 diabetic. The last summer, just as my numbers were getting into the normal range, I got stuck. My fasting blood glucose wasn't getting under 100 anymore. The information in this book pulled me back on track. This book is excellent for beginners and experienced keto alike. If you are looking for another fad diet, move on. But if you are looking for the change in your lifestyle for better overall health and longevity, this is a must have. I just want to say that hits home with me so much. As I look at the feedback I got from folks that came to this support group, again, a support group that is a place of vulnerability. And I actually was worried nobody would show up, that, okay, if I do this and I tell them that they're going to be on camera, will anybody want to come? And I'm very thankful to say, yes, they wanted to come, and they were so open and sharing. And I miss South Dakota. South Dakota, I think I was one person removed from the whole state. I think I knew the whole state, 5 generations there. And as I've come to Tampa, I totally am hungry for a community. And boy, they satisfied. It was really wonderful to get to know them. If I had my way, I would do that group exactly with them for the next 6 to 12 months, because I think I could really be integrated into the community with friendships and relationships like that. So it did spark some information that I'm going to go through here in a minute. And I'm going to start today with something that, oh Lord, I pray that this is going to work. I tested it before. It all looked like it was going well. And I'm going to play a video clip. Now, if you've been around the Dr. Voss channel long enough, you know that I've tried to do this before. So I'm going to click onto this, and you should be able to hear it's a 7-minute clip of a recap of these folks that totally opened up their hearts. I'm going to slide over a little bit so I can put that picture up there again. So these 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10 folks made it all 5 weeks. There were a couple of folks that tried to come and it just didn't work out for the timing in their life, but these guys made it 7 weeks. And we followed them along. I was on the edge of tears this last hour and a half because of how much impact just a simple support group had done for these people who had been struggling with their health, some of them doing everything right, but just stuck and not really finding that last bit of momentum to get them over what they needed for a healthy journey ahead. And so I'm going to share with you the clip, and then I'm going to recap on a couple of things that I learned that I took away from this course this support group, and then what I'm going to do next. So let's see. Pray this all works. Okay. If you can't hear this, you guys need to say something.
Let's have joy. Okay, so I'm going to start here by reminding you that this has been 5 weeks of a support group that you guys didn't know anything about each other when you came in. You had ideas about ketones, and you probably all knew what the keto continuum was, even if you didn't know where you were on it. But the purpose of what I did this bonus support group for was to try and teach people that the inside of a support group isn't so weird. It's just a support group. And so what I would like to hear from the three of you is, if you had, before you were in a support group, I'm going to ask, none of you were in a support group before, what is it that you learned in the support group that you think other people would be interested in, that like you, not been in? So let's leave with you, Joy.
Okay, well, the first thing, I'm going to repeat something that Eileen said. So I've been keto many times, and I'm very well versed in the ketogenic diet. But I didn't think I needed a support group. I thought I'm good. I have all the information I need. I don't need that. I'm good. So that was the first thing that I learned, because I absolutely learned stuff from the support group from every single person. So that's the first thing I would say that anybody would benefit from. So you think you don't need it, but you really don't need it. Secondly, for me, fasting was a no deal. When somebody said, "Oh, you gotta fast," I'm like, "Yeah, right, I'm not going without food." I don't know who you're talking to, even being keto, but I still learned in this group that you get that little push that somebody else is fasting, and you think, "Oh, well, I could do that." And so that's helped me also. I actually have successfully completed a 44-hour fast and 2 72-hour fasts just in the 5 weeks that we've met.
Wow.
And never fasted before. 16 hours straight, not fasting. So, yeah. And I, so that tremendously was huge for me and from this support group. And then thirdly, I want to say the benefit of support groups, our words are powerful. And, you know, we do have a tendency to say, well, you know, you should do this and you should do this. But to speak from your, what your experience is and say, well, this is what happened to me, comes across completely different to other people that are hearing that. And so I try to keep my mind to say it that way. And going back to that third thought, words are powerful, not only negative words, but also positive words. So like yakking the first week when I started my first fast, she texted me just a simple thing saying, you don't have to be perfect, you will be fine, and you can get back on the horse and start again. And those little words, now we could say that for ourselves all day long,
right?
But it's always more powerful when it comes from somebody else. And so that, those are the benefits for me of a support group.
Amen.
Wow, very good, yes.
Well, Pat, give me a, you are new to keto. Roped in by having to come to this thing.
Well, I've been thinking about it. Anyway, I thought I had done keto. I had not done keto before. And I've been looking into it. I was going to plan it. I bought some cookbooks. I was going to give it a shot. But I've learned from this that I'm not ready for those cookbooks. I just need to keep it simple and stay on track. But I wouldn't have known that had I not done this and done the course and learned from other people. What I've learned is that almost everybody in here has gone through something similar. They learned before me, and then maybe somebody else has learned from me. So it's been a great support, and everybody has been very supportive. And like, well, that happened to me, you can power through it, or try this to fix your problem. So that's what was so cool to me, is that everybody's on a different place of their continuum. And I think I can get there now. I would have never thought about doing a fast. I mean, my idea of a fast was not eating lunch. You know, maybe a day of fast. But I've learned that I feel so much better eating this way. And maybe I can do a fast one of these days. But I need to get back to the continuum and measure myself and learn what's going on so it makes sense. I think I'm a logical person. I need to understand what's going on, and this helps do that.
Wow, yeah. So, yeah, Joy had a season of keto behind her, and you were a newbie. And I think the presence on a group was from different points of view, but again, that support really penetrates into our spirits. And then, Christina, your attraction to the group was not really a weight loss journey, but more kind of learning for some loved ones. So tell me, what did you gain from the group that you think others might be interested in knowing?
So many things, really. I think, first of all, I would say that I really know now, having been in this group for 5 weeks, that a group, it really is the secret sauce for me. Because it is, in a way, such a unique way of living, and nobody in my life, my family, my friends, are living this way. And so to not be alone, to really feel fortified by everyone else's experiences and questions, has helped me so much and inspired me in a lot of different ways. And also, I've just noticed how that's really helped my husband, who isn't here in the group, but he's benefiting from the group. And I think that's what you mean when you talk about those mirror neurons, like when Alan was saying, just being here, he has these like subconscious things that he's getting in his brain. And it's just by seeing everybody else's journey, I'm getting so much out of that for my own, and realizing it's a trajectory. Like, you don't suddenly arrive at this like perfect keto place. And just like life, you know, we have our peaks and our valleys, right? And that's exactly what keto is like. And to know that that's, you know, everyone's unique, and we all have those peaks and valleys based on 100 million different factors, right? And to know that I have the confidence that I know how to handle those Mm-hmm. Yeah, and this group is giving me the confidence.
Yeah, that's brilliant. So thank you. Your testimonies have been helpful to reinforce me to start the local support group here in Tampa that I did in Sioux Falls, which I said I would do, but it's easy to put it off till next month. So thank you for participating and then just being brave enough to say, pick me to be part of your support group. So thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
And gained all the weight back. And as I listened to her story, she had checked her sugars a couple of times and said, geez, doc, why am I not losing weight like I did the first time? And one of the things I asked her to share was her morning sugars. Her morning sugars didn't have the numbers that were under 100 like they had the first time she did the ketogenic journey. As I look at the next steps that she was asked to do, I said, I want you to see if you can get that blood sugar under 100. And as I'm giving her that advice, I have a self-check, like, all right, when's the last time you checked your blood sugar when you weren't fasting? When I'm fasting, they look great, and because I've been fasting. But when I don't, when I don't check my own blood sugars, it's really easy to have that little bite of food at night or forget how hard it is or how much it impacts my blood sugars when I have a glass of wine. Knowing that when I check my blood sugars, my choices are better. And so as I gave her that advice, I didn't share that with the group. They didn't know that, but these are the kind of things that are the unspoken benefits of what happens inside a support group. So the next person there is Alan. And I tried calling him Harry the first week and Henry the second week, so he's got many names in my head, but his name is really Alan. And, you know, Alan had a classic setup of doing several things right. Like, he would run 9 to 10 miles. He would put in probably 15 miles of running a week. Yet he was really, and I think even several miles of swimming a week. So he was doing lots of things right, but really had a danger of disconnecting from the things he was eating because he was saying, well, I'm doing all this exercise. And I think despite having read the books, despite knowing what a ketone was, despite hearing the stories that were inside the keto continuum for David, that story, his understanding of insulin went from hearing about it, but it must be somebody else's problem, to really owning it, like really being able to maximize his ownership that what's happening to you is that you have not just a little bit of a problem with insulin, but you've been having an insulin problem for a long time. And I know that personally, he really wanted to get that better. As he heard the stories of other people around the room, you could hear him connect to a change. And it wasn't even something that I think he recognized until maybe the fifth week, where he's like, I kept hearing stories from you. And then a few days later, I would remember your stories. I would remember that you said this. And I talk a lot about in that class, mirror neurons, that as adults, one of the best ways we learn is to watch somebody struggle or watch somebody use grace. And Alan was a perfect example that this doesn't have to be exciting. I mean, it's not this holy moly moment, but it really improves how they can take ownership of the problem and then really be able to make that change in the choices he made because of insulin. So it sounds like it's disconnected, like insulin is this goofy thing and it's really somebody else's problem. But now, after he's had several weeks with the ketogenic journey inside a support group, he has a different appreciation for what his insulin is doing, and now his choices are better. So Jacqueline is the one in the front, and if you read any of the emails, I called her my favorite. This cost a little bit of a moment, but she is truly local here to Tampa, and I'm truly interested in hoping that she'll come to the local support group. She also had a very important connection, which was she's trying to teach her family and her friends and her children about how to eat keto. And on the very first visit, I can remember the moment where I said, I need to stop preaching to my children and really just own that they will do what I do. And if I do a better job of taking care of me, they're going to do a better job of taking care of them. So Jacqueline was also had some struggles with a toothache throughout the journey. And even just 5 weeks of not having, just having that pain was a reminder to all of us that, yeah, guess what? It doesn't feel good to have that much pain. And when you do, it's harder to be forgiving of yourself. But she did a good job. She had that support to really lean on. Joy was another one of my favorites. She was very articulate and also is, she's a woman in a place where lots of men do her job. She is a police officer, is police officer. I think there's another word she used, but so if I'm saying the wrong word, I'm sorry. She is authority in the police department. But what she really wanted was, as she's heading into retirement in the next year, she really wanted her health to take it to the next level. And I love some of her honesty that I don't think she's ever going to try a sardine. But she also said she was never going to fast. And when she did that first fast, and it kind of blew her own mind that she could do that, that she could really find fasting to be a positive part of her life and to be so powerful, that she had she really inspired the group and was able to lead by example, that when you step over a threshold that you don't think you can do inside a support group, she actually had blood sugars in the 38 range and thought, this can't be healthy. So she provided me with lots of teachable moments. So again, when I look at that, I can remember the first time my blood sugars were in the 30s, and I thought, okay, for years I have told patients, I have grabbed that D5W and given them an infusion of glucose, even when they were talking to me during that, you know, blood sugar of, you know, 38. Now that's really low, but at the same time, her ketones were like 5.5 or 6 during those times. And what she was able to example to the group is, you know, she had, you know, ketones of 0.4 at the beginning of this support group, so that she launched her ketones into a very high level while dropping her glucose, and then having such an awesome mental like improvement of energy and appetite suppression. She's like, everywhere I go, I say your name. My boss, every word that comes out of my mouth is, you should do that. Keto will help that. Keto will help that. And she's not lying. It's that the transformation in her own health and the process of watching her not believe that it would be that impactful in her as well. Almost like the same struggle that Alan had, that insulin was going to improve him or that was going to impact him, was what Joy had as she said, hey, can this improvement, you know, you're not really talking about me having that improvement in my mind, are you? And of course, the answer was yes. All right, let's go. Oh, not, that's not what I wanted to do. I wanted to do this. There we go. All right, so next we have Happy, who I will tell you has also been very near and dear to my heart. She's lost a loved one over the last year and really wants to not only improve her health, but really find that sense of purpose back in her life. And she's had success in the past. So as she comes into the group, and as her past, she wants that repeat success. She has this gorgeous picture of her a few years ago where she was fit and in one of the best seasons of her life. And with the grief and the journey she's been through, it's not as easy. And as she entered the group, she made the best statement at the end of the day, at the end of this support group. She's like, I came into this thinking, I'm going to follow these rules and I'm going to, you know, take this course and it's going to be this perfect improve. And then I'm going to be in that happily ever after and really find that this is exactly how you do it. But as she watched the other people in the support group struggle and then get a little better and then fall off the wagon, but have the grace to say, okay, I did that. And the other part was, as Happy returned back to a ketogenic journey where she had had success, but just was in a season of life where it's harder. It's just not as much, she can't be as intense or it will overwhelm her. And boy, do I know all about that. And I've seen patients like that where, as they say, I'm gonna, you know, give up booze forever, and they make it a week and then they're drinking again. And then they come back to group and say, how do I start again? And watching people struggle with that in a way that isn't shameful, isn't a place where you say, how dare you, but instead saying, gosh, I've been there, and I know that it's through hurt and through loss and disappointment that when we have a plan for giving up carbohydrates and keeping those under 20 and not snacking after certain hours, and then reality hits and you say, I just couldn't push any harder. I think that's really one of the blessings that Happy brought to us, is that I have no doubt that she'll get her health back, but it is through a support group that she'll get it back quicker, and she won't stay down. You know, when she falls off the wagon, like many people, it's disappointing, it's hard. But as she forgives herself, that process becomes quicker and easier. So I really enjoyed her education, and again, just her vulnerability for saying, I'm not doing it all perfectly, but I am trying, and she really was. It was very nice to see that. Let's see if I can push this button right. Okay, so next we have Christina. And Christina, again, was the lady at the end who you couldn't hear her voice very, you couldn't see her because I had the wrong camera on. I'm sorry. But she really was inspiring. She doesn't need to lose weight. She came into this ketogenic support group really to improve her health a little bit, but wanted to learn more about what it could do for her husband. And just then watching how in 5 weeks of stabilizing her diet, pushing her fasting a little more, she said something remarkable, which was, I can't believe how much more stable my mood is. And she's a pretty calm person. She's one of those you want to just kind of, you can feel the love come from her eyes to other people. It's easy to be attracted to her generous heart. And so I would, at first glance, you would say, well, how could this woman have anything but a stable mood? But the stress of an ill husband and a chronically deteriorating disorder that she's really trying to help her husband with, I'm sure weighs on her. And she goes, I can't believe how when I am more stable, how much that translates to the other people around her. And maybe that I only got to spend five, maybe by the time you add up all five support groups, let's say maybe maximum 8 hours together, that in the 8 hours I knew Christina, it was this generous heart that you could almost feel as you got into her personal space, like she is filled with love. And if that wasn't there before, God bless her for being able to find it and share that with others, because that was her most remarkable thing at the end, was I can't believe how much more stable my mood was. And truly, I do think she's right. Okay, so the next person I have is Pat, which I keep trying to call Kim, but her name is really Pat. There were two keto newbies, and I kind of got them messed up when I mentioned their names. So this is Pat, and she was roped in by her good friend Eileen to come to the group. And her summary there in that video, if you couldn't connect, she was like, I was going to do all these things with this cookbook, and I was really kind of having this master plan. And what she was really struggling with was getting started. And I can remember how much I did not want to get started with fasting, how much I had, I'm good enough, I don't need to do this more. And it was actually because my mom needed to fast that I said, okay, I'll do it with you, Mom. And when I looked at her stuckness that she talked about, that, I was going to do keto. And then she finally did keto in a way that was surrounded by a support group. The amount of keto information and really the intensity of what she was able to see a transformation in 5 weeks. She actually started a week before the group, so she's at 6 weeks. what people doing it on their own, that would take them 6 months. Because what she learned was as she watched Alan or Christina or Tammy, as they shared their journey, they were at different parts of that keto continuum. But what Pat was able to gain was their knowledge of the experience that her mirror neurons could pick up and say, all right, I'm not at that stage yet, but I can understand and appreciate that where I am at is a pretty good place. And that came from the sharing. All right, we got a couple more left, and then I will get to your questions here, because I do think that's one of the best parts about these lives is getting to your questions. All right, so I'm going to put Roland and Eileen on at the end. So Roland was another one of my favorites, actually. So he came in struggling with the ability to really get back on board, that he's had some health problems in the past, and when he did keto, he felt awesome, but there was something about the stuckness, like he couldn't really step over the threshold and commit. But as soon as he got selected to be in the support group, the gloves were off and he was ready to really hone into this. And my favorite part was actually, I think, the third or maybe it was the fourth week, where he is golfing with some men much younger than him. And they're on the back nine and he's winning. He's doing very well. And he said, well, I must have to admit that I have a significant advantage because I've been on this ketogenic diet. And in the 5 weeks he returned to the gym, he said he was really working on building up his muscle mass. But before he started, his belt was at that final notch where he's like, I knew better. This is a place where once I get past this weight, it's really hard to come off. So not only did he lose the weight in the 5 weeks, I love that he outgolfed the younger men. And as he walked out today, I said, you know, you golf in this area, and I know one thing about Florida that you have like a million more golf courses than we did in South Dakota. So I've had him commit to taking me golfing. I told him it has to be best ball though, because I don't practice enough to be that good. And then finally, Eileen was the last person, I think the last person on the picture. I got to make sure I got everybody in the picture, but I'll do that in a second. And Eileen, actually, she was another very important part of the final, there all 5 weeks, but was a very important part of, she thought, I don't really need this. She had actually has been a blessing to me and has helped with a few items around setting up this office and getting things done. And as I'm asking about the support group, I said, well, you got to come. And she's like, you know, I don't really need it, but I'll come if it's helpful to you. And what she found was that by being part of the support group, not only did she take her confidence of, you know, life has seasons, and when you fall off the keto wagon, there's a few things, but getting back on it really do. She cleaned up her keto enough that she brought about the keto rash, and we use that as a huge teachable moment in today's lesson. So if you didn't get to watch that, watching the replay on it inside the course, I talk all about why the keto rash happens and then why it's so important to not fall off the wagon if you get the keto rash. But beyond her keto rash, the part that was inspiring was how much she said, I was doing fine. And then within this support group, these other people inspired me to be better and to not fall off the wagon as long. And it's that kind of a community effort that I really think support groups do change how we think about not just improving our health, but sustaining it. And then the confidence to spread it to other people is really where it becomes not just a little bit better, but an amazing change of those who've been in a support group and those who haven't. When they've been in a support group, they weather the storms, they take on the challenges and step over a threshold much quicker than they would have had they not been a support group. But when they fail, what support does is you get to share that failure and receive that grace from those other people who are also trying to be better. And she did a great job of sharing the grace and also just being a good example of how support groups can make all the difference when you show up and offer your vulnerability, offer your journey as well. All right, let's just make sure I got everybody in there. Go like this. I think. And then, oh gosh, I totally forgot one. I'm so sorry. This is a good thing I did that. All right, so we have the last one. I'm totally going to have to think of her name as I'm doing this, and I'm blanking. I'll just tell you who she is. So this was my retired nurse. And if nothing was inspiring, it was her commitment to getting past what had not been a fasting routine to the best, maybe the best faster in the group by the end. And when she was able to not just push through the first one, she thought she was doing okay. And the second week, I had them all check their uric acid at the end of, again, point of care, one of the four care things. I use the, you know, the four care meters to check my ketones and glucose, and you can buy the strips for uric acid. So I checked everybody's uric acid. And although she had done this awesome job of improving, Ginny is her name. Thank you very much. That just came to me. Sorry. Ginny had done a great job of improving her ketones and really didn't have a lot of weight to lose. She also came to the group with this really rich understanding of the ketogenic diet and was able to like carry on with some of the education that I've said so many times. It's really nice when other people say, here's why that happens and this is what you should do. I'm like, yep, she's spot on. She was very good. But as she saw her uric acid be higher than she expected, it was so inspiring to see this woman who really didn't need to lose weight step up her game, push that fasting to a level that was 72 hours. And after she succeeded, she instantly said, I'm going to do this for the consecutive 8 weeks, which is the, you know, level 12 of the keto continuum, something that you don't have to do. But when you're looking for that autophagy, where you're looking for that maximum health, that's a very powerful change in how autophagy happens and how being consistently keto is to practice that fasting 8 weeks in a row. And Ginny not only did a great job of the fasting, she was an example for others to say, wow, if she can do it, then I can do it. And that's hats off to her inspiration to the other people and to just each week I looked forward to, you know, how she'd done. And she was the one who said, a glucose of 38. And I have that instant panic too, because I've said, oh, that has to be too low. But indeed it is not. All right, so we're going to go over to your questions. I just want to say one more time to the whole group. Let's see if I can pull their picture up all the way here. Do this and pull this down just a little bit and say thank you to all these great volunteers that were part of my support group for the first one in Tampa. I am looking at the next several weeks ahead to trying to get the local support group here to inside the Tampa area. Inside the Tampa area to be right across the parking lot. I think we have a place we're going to do it, and it will be the free version. It will be those who are in my community can show up and be part of my support group. But I'll tell you, I couldn't have had the strength to start that support group without those volunteers coming in and letting me start with a small pocket, get my legs under me again after the move, and remember why it is that I'm so attracted to doing this. I said, I think this is my superpower, is that I'm meant to be in communication and in an educational role for people trying to improve their health. This channel does some of that. We're going to get over to answering your questions right now. And I'm going to give you a little foreshadowing that the Brains course is coming up again. And if anybody is looking to become my patient, you're going to want to have taken the Brains course. You'll have more about that coming up in the next weeks. And I am going to go to the good questions here. So we have a few questions here in front of us. We're going to start with Sherry Rogers. And she actually has had a low iron. So she went into the doctor and she had her iron checked. She found it to be very high and found that I needed a specific test. Can you tell me what that is? So that's a good question. I get this a lot, so thank you for asking that question. Iron is, again, an important part of making neurotransmitters and really important part of overall health, but excessive amounts of iron actually will age your body too quickly. So it is really important that you don't just look at the one number called ferritin when thinking about iron. So when you look at the ferritin, ferritin is actually a protein that transports iron around. And you can find this protein elevated in people who have chronic inflammation. So we call it a inflammatory response marker, meaning if I would give, if Sherry was around and I would, you know, she'd get a big bruise on her arm, the inflammation, the acute phase reactant, that's actually the word I was looking for. Iron is, or ferritin is known for being an acute phase reactant. So if she had a big bruise on her arm, we would see the ferritin skyrocket. It's a protein that would become in excess during a time of recent inflammation. The trouble with being in an insulin-resistant state, which is a state of inflammation, that chronic inflammation continually stimulates the ferritin to be present. So they have these really high ferritin levels, and ferritin is usually the protein that carries around iron. So there's a correlation in healthy people without inflammation that the ferritin and the iron are going to kind of match one another. The ferritin goes up, that's the protein that carries the iron, that means the iron goes up. But that's not the case when people are in chronic inflammation. They have an abundance of ferritin, but I think of those as the buses around the body that's carrying iron. But the buses on the seat that are supposed to be filled with iron are mostly empty. So to know if that's the if your ferritin is carrying around plenty of iron, we need her to get an iron saturation and a total iron binding capacity. Those are fancy words. TIBC and iron saturation is in a panel. So instead of just saying, I want my iron checked, you got to get the iron studies or an iron studies panel, or sometimes called an iron panel. You'll know that it's the right one when you have total iron binding capacity or the iron saturation. And what they're really looking for is, okay, so you got a bunch of ferritin, but how much of the ferritin is carrying iron? And then they can do a calculation to say, is that enough iron? Is that excessive iron or not? So, good question. Okay, let's move on to kidneys and magnesium. My creatinine clearance is 90, but my EGFR, that's the estimated glomerular filtration rate, fluctuates between 50 and 59. So I have to be a little cautious regarding my kidneys in the warnings of milk of magnesia. Okay, so they're worried about magnesium, especially magnesium floats, with a creatinine clearance of 90 or a glomerular filtration rate between 50 and 59. First of all, any score above 60 is considered almost perfect. It's not really perfect, but we do not worry about kidneys when they have an estimated glomerular filtration rate above 60. And then to have a creatinine clearance, which is another way to look at how well is the kidney cleaning out the system, your doctor can give you a warning that those are on the edge, but I wouldn't, the easiest molecule for them to handle is going to be magnesium. So putting magnesium into your system through an Epsom salt float, I don't want to give medical advice over the, but if it was my dad, I would not be worried about that. His kidney function was in the less than 20%. So his EGFR was less than 20. So you've heard me talk about my dad's kidney function and he ended up on dialysis. That was a much different pattern of failure. So to know the potassium effect on kidneys, again, it is a specific question that will be related to how your kidneys are doing and how long they took to get a decline in their function, because the estimated glomerular filtration rate, the perfect score is 100. So between 50 and 59, although I'm kind of saying you're not going to have any problem handling magnesium at that point, you don't want it to get worse. You want it to get better. And kidneys love to work in a setting of low inflammation. So not only giving them the right electrolytes, but also giving them the improvement in the anti-inflamed state by a constant state of ketosis is one of the best things. If my dad would have done that for his kidneys 15 years before he started spilling protein, that would have been, it could have been life-changing for him. All right, how much salt water should I drink each day while fasting? All right, so I get this question a lot. Again, salt, is about the replacement of the minerals that you're losing in each day. So the blanket statement of minerals needed or milligrams needed of sodium and chloride and magnesium is a little too nuanced, meaning each person would have a different answer. What I like to hear about is that they are having enough salt that their thirst is satisfied. You say, wait, doesn't salt make you thirsty? No, when you add salt to a body that's losing salt, you can satiate their thirst. They can satisfy their thirst. So when I look at people who are not feeling, I look at symptoms a lot for when I answer this question, because I can chase it in a place where their salt intake has some milligrams, and I can then check their numbers the next week. But your kidneys are so much faster and so much quicker at stabilizing that salt intake and the salt need that I tell them to look for as you swallow salt. Like I use the Soleil water. I put some of the crystals from the Redmond Salt, Real Salt Company, in a mason jar, and I put some distilled water in it. And I use that water in my coffee. I use that water in my drink. And I know that at the end of my coffee, it's very salty at the bottom. But during a fasting day like today, I know that the bottom of my coffee cup has only about a little bit of coffee in it, but it's really salty. So I will take a sip of that throughout the day on a fasting day, knowing that after I do that and then I drink some water, if I don't have a signal for thirst, I'm keeping up with it. So a better answer for this isn't just that how much salt do I drink in a day, it's how thirsty did you feel throughout the day, and when you added the salt, were you able to drink past it without continuing that constant sense of thirst? I hope that made sense. Okay. So in August, I had a C6, C7. I'm going to guess this ACDF is a fusion of one of the parts of the spine. My fasting blood sugar is a little over 100. Is that due to the surgery, inflammation, or meds? So again, there's a lot going on in that story. The fasting blood sugar is elevated with stress, but what was your sugar before that? And were you checking your sugar before that? Inflammation can cause that. The steroids that they often put on when they post surgery to keep the inflammation low can for sure cause the glucose to be elevated. So all of those things are possible answers to that question. We'll do one more and call it good. So are there specific strategies for keeping a Dr. Boz ratio under 20? Support community for therapeutic keto. I'm at Keto Continuum number 8. Good job. That's where he or she keeps the eating window within an hour with 11 to 12 weekly. I'm guessing he does a fast of either a 48-hour fast or a 72-hour fast weekly. Under the primary care physician's care, he's wonderful, but doesn't have any guidance. Okay, so keeping a Dr. Boz ratio under 20. I'm going to go back to this page over here so you can see me a little better. Maybe I am. Hold on. Here we go. So keeping a Dr. Boz ratio under 20 is difficult. I'm going to check my sugars at the end here just to wrap this up. When I was taking care of my mom who had cancer, or when I have a patient that's under treatment for a severe cancer, when I have patients who have seizures, we work to keep that Dr. Boz ratio under 20. It is not easy. If you have not bought the workbook, in the workbook I have a couple of advanced fasting options, and those advanced fasting options have to do with just this question. Like, if I am pushing somebody's metabolism to keep their glucose really low, and of course that will push their ketones higher naturally, as you do that, as you watch this support group, I don't know if you tuned in for that, but the support group had some people whose ketones were like at 4.5 because they had never been keto before. Their body was almost overproducing them because There was no risk of, I mean, they had no cells that were that knew how to use those ketones. They were producing them without a lot of demand yet. But when you get into the advanced levels of ketones and you're fighting off a cancer, so again, ketones 2.4, glucose 85. So that was my, again, numbers at the end of drinking a supplement should change, people. If they don't change, switch supplements. And again, I'd like to, I have lots of people writing in over the last couple weeks what meter I use. I use the ForaCare meter. That is because I can test more than one thing and I find it the most reliable. Going back to that, that Dr. Paul's ratio of less than 20. So once they're keto adapted, your body's gonna always reach for a homeostasis. So it's going to push that glucose up and bring those ketones down, not wasting fuel. So as it tries to do that, we're gonna push those certain patients that have either seizures or have had have a cancer protocol that we're trying to match. We're going to push their metabolisms. So as you look in some in that workbook, there is a place where you said, yep, if you've figured out how to do 72-hour fast and you've really graduated and feeling stable in this, and now you want to keep that Dr. Paul's ratio under 20, we've narrowed the eating window to 1 hour, or maybe it's 2 hours for them. We've taken it out of the evening hours, pushed it as close to sunrise as their life can handle it. And then we start weighing food. I don't mean calories, I mean the total grams of food per day are weighed. So that's one way that we do it. The grams usually need to be under 500 to keep it under that 20, Dr. Paul's ratio of 20, that's a GKI of 1:1. The other thing that I've done is we've just done an every other day fast where they eat every 48 hours. They can eat a few more grams. They can eat probably 800 to 900 grams of food if they have a meal every other day. But it's really difficult. I would not do this alone. I would have somebody that you're doing this in partnership with, because it's really hard to keep it there. My question would be, why would they push it that low? The only times I would push a patient that hard constantly, like a constant Dr. Paul's ratio of less than 20, is when they have severe medical issues we're trying. I mean, we have a life or death thing we're facing at that point. Because pulsing and stressing the body to a Dr. Paul's ratio will ignite some autophagy. It will stress their metabolism. I think of it as giving their mitochondria a workout. But it doesn't necessarily, well, it's really difficult, first of all, if you have any the constant state of keeping that Dr. Paul's ratio that low. It's a really aggressive stress. So my underlying question for that would be, why are you pushing that hard? If it's a weight loss thing, don't push so hard. That, if it's a life or death thing, that's where your doctor needs to kind of check in, should reach out to me, or Dr. Seyfried is the other one who does a really good job on that protocol. He's out of Boston. And he's a connector too. All right, so I just want to know that for those of you watching this on the replay, if you would like to learn about one of the support groups that I led, there's a great example that I'll link to at the end of this show that you can watch me lead a live, one of my support groups in one of our videos there. It just kind of gives you a hint to what those other folks were looking at over the last 5 weeks. So I am signing off as the Dr. Paul Show. Once again, on this channel, we are all about reversing your medical problems one ketone at a time. So we are healthy keto living here. We will see you next week. Thank you, everybody, for tuning in.